That's me, Luke, eating a delicious baozi.
Now you may be wondering, is this just going to be another Chinese action movie? Well, you're wrong. In fact, I was going to showcase the music town in China after I was blown away by first-hand accounts of Chinese opera. A mellifluous flautist. And an intrepid violinist. I could show a full 8 minutes of my friend Pong Pong eating a whole assortment of foods. But then I remembered, that's too mainstream. At last, I was stumped. Overwhelmed. China and its age of ambition got to me. There was so much to talk about, but so little time. And so, I called a trusted friend. One would say an expert on Chinese civilization. I would say guru. His name is Will Fullerton, a man I trust, a man I love. He is more than a friend. I now consider him a brother.
Thanks for the theatrics, Luke, but I'll take it from here. We started our trip in Shanghai, China, a city of about 28 million people. Skyscrapers for as long as you can see. A city that's modern, industrial, international, a finance and commerce capital of the world. But we had a question. Had Shanghai always been this way? And the answer that we found was relatively simple. No. Shanghai 150 years ago was merely a fishing village. And it actually wasn't until after the First Opium War in 1842, when the British signed the Treaty of Nanjing with China, that Shanghai was named one of its 5 treaty ports, thus opening Shanghai to foreign involvement. Of the 5 new treaty ports, only Shanghai became a boom town when extensive concession areas of marshy and largely uninhabited countryside were made available for the British, French, and other foreign settlements. Of the most notable would be the Shanghai Bund, an area of the Huangpu River that housed numerous banks and trading houses from all over the world. Shanghai became a place of opulence, the best art, great architecture, and the greatest place to do business in Asia. However, in the 1950s, Shanghai became largely closed off to the outside world and dealt largely with only socialist countries. It wasn't until another 30 years when Richard Nixon's famous meeting in Shanghai would lay the groundwork for the China that we would all know today. In just 40 years from that date, Shanghai has become once again one of China's most important cities for finance and world trade. The Shanghai port is one of the largest and most widely used in the world. Shanghai is once again a city of paradox and great change, as you see the colonial architecture at the Bund and also the forest of cranes and new skyscrapers that paint the Shanghai skyline. The next leg of our journey would be to Beijing, China, a city formerly known as Peking with over 3,000 years of recorded history. Beijing is one of the world's greatest cities because of the profound cultural importance of places like the Temple of Heaven, the Forbidden City, Tiananmen Square, and, of course, the Great Wall of China. But apart from the 3,000 years of history and all the cultural landmarks, Beijing is the current center of politics and is the capital of the People's Republic of China.
Wow, Will. As I'm on the train here telling this guy how you saved the video with your deep knowledge about the history of Shanghai and Beijing, I am very thankful. I would have never been able to explain the roots of modern China. I would have just talked about how at Disneyland I noticed there were barely any kids. In fact, the guy sitting in front of me on the log ride was 33 years old and taking his wife out for the day. I bet you $5 they got nostalgic when Mulan made an appearance at the parade.
Or
I would have gotten distracted with the outdoor gyms and massage areas, like this lady going to town. With that being said, I could have even cracked a joke about how ironic it was to be carrying an American flag in Tiananmen Square. Thank goodness I didn't go on a tangent talking about China's intense focus on the technology of the future, because that would have been a bore. It would have been horrible if I tried to make an argument that the Chinese kick the birdie game is way better than the American teenage game of hacky sack. And I was also going to propose that from my research in China, America should only use bike transportation to become a greener society. You don't even want to know what I cooked in this pot because I don't even have words to describe it. Maybe there was some of this facial hair though. Well, at least I tried. Thank goodness I had Will Fullerton to show me the enlightened path and thoroughly describe China's rise. Yesterday and today.